Good morning. As you can tell, again, I'm not Lyndy. Lyndy changes from week to week, but she is not feeling well this morning, but I do want to give you announcements. First of all, before we do anything else, I want us to stop and to acknowledge what happened 21 years ago this day. I think we all remember exactly where we were when the planes hit the building and how our hearts just was broken and 2,996 lives were lost. And so our hearts just continually want to go out and remember that tragedy, but also to remember the hope that we found through it. And so just remember that today is a solemn day for many and for us as we remember the loss of life from that day. A couple announcements I'd like to make. First of all, our preschool starts tomorrow. And so we're going to have a bunch of kids running around the church making lots of noise, and it's going to be wonderful, and what a blessing. And so please be in prayer for this. Be in prayer for our little kids. I'm going to ask that tomorrow morning, or just today or tomorrow, if you get a chance, go by the preschool area and just pray. Just go and grab a chair and say, Lord, pray. Because I'll tell you, last year we had some kids y'all didn't pray enough for. Okay? We had one kid who said that he had the devil in him, and you could tell because there was green stuff coming out of his nose. And so y'all need to be praying for these kids. But it's something we do take seriously. And y'all, one of the things that we take very importantly is that when these kids walk through these doors, A, we want them to know that they are loved by God, and B, we want them to know they are loved by us. And so these kids may not have a church home anywhere else, but we want them to know that this is their home. And so these kids who come to preschool, they are our kids. So there is still some preschool buddies that you can sign up for. So if you haven't done that yet, get in contact with our church office and we'll try to get you connected to where you'll be assigned one of our preschool kids that you'll be in prayer for the entire year and just kind of connect with them. Also, our lifeline is next Saturday. And so you'll see inside your bulletin the stuff that is needed for that. And then next Sunday, y'all. Next Sunday is the big day. That is our second annual chili cook-off. Now, last year's champion is here with us this morning, Katherine Tolliver. And she is going down. But it's going to be a great fun. So what we're going to do is we invite you to bring your chili. Make your best chili you can. If you don't want to make chili, you can make sandwiches or just soup or whatever, little goodies and bring. But we're going to have a potluck after church. And so after church, we're going to go down. We have supposedly unbiased judges who will judge these chilies on taste, on presentation, originality, and godliness. And so, but we are looking forward to that. So y'all, next Saturday. And so this is a great chance for you to invite your friends and family, say, hey, y'all, come with us, come worship with us, and then come enjoy a bowl of chili with me. Okay? Are there any other announcements we need to make before we go any further? What's that? It's Grandparents Day. I didn't know that. Okay. One day I'll know. We'll say happy Grandparents Day to everybody. We appreciate that. Before we begin our worship service, y'all would notice in your bulletin there are some changes. So the order of worship. Now I know a lot of times we just go through the order of worship, and you know, one of the things I love, C.S. Lewis used to say that you should keep your worship routine so that you don't have to think about it too much, so that you can just focus on God. But every now and then, it's good to change things up. Well, this past week, we learned some things at this conference we went to, and it was so powerful. And so there are some things we've added in here that I just want you to know. And the first thing you'll notice is that when we do our call to worship afterwards, we're going to have a song of adoration, okay? And that's where your call to worship and your first response is just to say, thank you, God, how great you are. And so the song we're going to sing is the chorus from His Mercy Is More. And we've sang that here before. Chris will lead us into it. So we're going to do the call to worship, and immediately after that, Chris will lead us in the adoration of our God. We'll have the opening prayer and then go into our next song, okay? But I want to invite you to stand. And as we prepare our hearts to worship in faithfulness the one true God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, we will hear our call to worship and respond to our adoration. Praise the Lord. How good it is to sing praises to our God. How pleasant and fitting to praise Him.
And the chorus sings,
Praise the Lord, His mercy is more, stronger than darkness, new every morn. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more.
Let's pray. Father, as we now enter into this time of worship, let our hearts rejoice in You. Help us to draw near to You as You have promised to draw near to us. May our voices not be timid, but help us to sing so loud that all of heaven hears and all of hell fears. Help us to sing the song of the redeemed, those redeemed by grace and the shed blood of Jesus Christ. And let us sing with a grateful heart for all He has done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Another hymn we're going to sing, Remain Standing, Christ Our Hope in Life and Death. We have done before, too. Choir relearned it again Wednesday night, so they're going to kind of help you restart it again, too. So Patrick.
What is our hope in life and death? Christ alone, Christ alone. What is our only confidence that our souls to Him belong? Who holds our days within His hand? What comes apart from His command? And what will keep us till the end? The love of Christ in which we stand. Forevermore.
Oh, sing hallelujah.
How many of you ever read The Pilgrim's Progress? Great book, and there's one of my favorite scenes in that book where the character by the name of Christian is carrying his backpack. The whole story is one big allegory. And as he is carrying this backpack, it symbolizes all of his guilt, all of his shame, all of his burdens, all of his problems. And he's trying to climb up this mountain, and it's just getting overwhelming on him. He just can't stand it. He's just struggling so much. But then as he gets closer, he looks up, and there he sees the cross. And when he sees the cross in all of its glory, all of a sudden the backpack just falls off and rolls down the hill into an open grave where it is swallowed up. And it's a way to remind us that we come to a God who takes away our guilt and our shame and our burdens. And I love that picture, because one aspect we often neglect in our worship is that we come here to lay our burdens down, to confess our sins to Him, and be reminded of that grace of God. So many times we come and we just carry so much on us, and we forget that we are brought here. And God says, here, bring those to me. Lay them on me. Let me have those so that you don't bear them. And so we're going to have a little prayer of confession. We're going to have a reminder of God's amazing grace. And then we're going to have our call to prayer, and the altar will be open for you to come and to lay those burdens down. So join me with our prayer confession. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Now hear these words. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your soul. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, you are the way, you are the truth, and you are the life. You are truly good, and you are from everlasting to everlasting. You are holy, and you are love. You dwell in unapproachable light, yet you call us and enable us to come and to behold your glory. You invite us to come and to cast our cares and our anxieties upon you, because your word says you care for each and every one of us. Lord, we come and we bring to you those burdens that are heavy on our hearts. Lord, we bring to you our families. We bring to you our nation. We bring to you this world. And Lord, we even bring ourselves and all the trials and tribulations we face. And Lord, as much as we care about these things, we know that you care all the much more. So Lord, we adore you. This morning, may we have just a glimpse of your glory. May we experience that peace and joy that comes from knowing Jesus Christ as not only our Lord and our Savior, but as the God of all comfort, who hears our every prayer, who knows even when a single hair from our head falls. May we come boldly before your throne, knowing that we come in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Help us to love you. Help us to love one another, and help us to love more and more. And may all that we do and say be done for your glory as a response to your amazing love for us. So, Lord, as with a grateful and redeemed heart, we ask all this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Amen.
We had the privilege this weekend in Nashville to actually see Bill and Gloria Gaither, who wrote our next hymn. And it was such a neat blessing just to see those people and to hear how they came about writing the hymns. So if you would stand and sing with us, and I just ask that as you sing, you stop and think. Remember that time when he actually touched you. Or maybe it was this week. Maybe it was when you first met Christ. But let's sing together hymn 367.
I do love that song. As Christians, we share a story that spans over 2,000 years. And sometimes I think we think that everything we do is brand new, but we have this faith that comes from a foundation that has been built upon by generations past. And in generations past, they were asked, what are the truths that you hold dear? What are the truths that are the foundation for your life? What are the truths that you are willing to die for? And from the very beginning, it was passed down to us from those who walk with Jesus themselves that these are the core bedrock truths of our faith. And they are put into a creed, which is called the Apostles' Creed, which kind of sums up what is at the essence of everything we believe. And I know a lot of times we go through these as just like, let's just mumble this together. You know, like, we all sound like Charlie Brown's teaching, like, wah, 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 wah. But y'all, I want you to hear, when the church was asked, sum up your faith. What is it that you need to believe to be a follower of Jesus Christ? This is what they held true to their hearts. And I want us to not only, you know, have the emotional, which I love the emotion, but I want us to have that knowledge in our head so when a crisis comes and someone says, what do you believe? And we can say, this is our faith. This is what we hold dear. When you face that crisis and you think I'd have no foundation to stand on. You say, yes, this is my foundation. And his name is Jesus. So we're going to say this, but I don't want you to mumble it, okay? I want you to say it as if you're standing in Rome 2,000 years ago. You're with those Christians who are being persecuted. I want you to say it as you're standing with Augustine, with Wesley, with Luther, Spurgeon, with your grandparents, your parents, that this is our shared faith as the body of Christ. So I'm going to ask you to stand up for this. And then after we share our faith together, we're going to bust out in doxology, okay? Y'all know we normally do this after the offering, but we're going to do it after the creed. And I want y'all to, again, just sing out loud, because this faith changes our life. And so let's praise God for it. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. You have blessed us in so many ways. You've given us so many things, and we are so grateful. And so, Lord, with a grateful and cheerful heart, we now return these tithes and offerings unto you, and we ask that you would bless these to further your kingdom. For in Christ's holy and precious name we pray. Amen. This time, I invite all of our young kids come forward for a moment with children.
Hey, Lincoln.
Oh, wow, that's awesome. All right. Oh, she's shy. It's okay. Oh, there was Miss Katie. All right. Well, I've told this story before, but it's always one of my favorite stories. You already know? Okay, what story am I telling? Jesus. Jesus always is. Kind of, yeah, you're right, Lincoln. Yeah. But my story that I love to tell is one about how whenever we lose something, We always search for it, right? Y'all ever lost something very important to you? Yeah. You got a treasure box? Yeah. Yeah. Well, I want to tell y'all something that happened to me this past week. I was at this conference, and I went to the bookstore, and I bought a book. Yeah, it was just like a giant book fair. Yeah, but this was in Nashville. Yeah, y'all went there? Yeah, well, I bought these books, and I was so excited, and I wanted to read them so much. But then I went to our place we were staying, and I went to go find my book, and guess what? I couldn't find it. I looked in my suitcase. It wasn't there. I looked inside my room. It wasn't there. I looked in the van. It wasn't there. I could not find it anywhere. I was just so upset because these books cost money, and they will really want to read them. But somebody robbed it? Well, no, somebody didn't rob it. But you think mom robbed it? No, actually, come find out, it was in Chris Tolliver's vehicle. And when Chris found it for me, Chris said, "Barry, I found your book." And guess what I did? I was like, "Yeah! Yeah!" I was so happy. Well, Jesus told a story similar to that. He said that there was this lady, and she had lost her coin. One coin. She had 10 coins, but she had lost one, and she couldn't find it. And so she went and swept the entire house. But when she found it, you know what she did? Yeah! And Jesus also said there was a shepherd. He had 100 sheep. 99 were with him, but one went astray. But he went and left the 99, found the one, and when he found it, guess what he did? Yay! And Jesus says, yeah, that's what happens when one person repents and comes to know Jesus Christ. All of heaven celebrates. All of heaven goes, yay! All right, well, let's bow our heads. Thank you. Dear Heavenly and Gracious Father, thank you so much for the celebration in heaven. Thank you so much for these kids. And Lord, I pray that they always remember how much you love them and how much we love them. Lord, I pray that you would bless these kids in every way. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, y'all come get a piece of candy.
When I look upon was beautiful. Thank you. Our scripture reading today will be from Habakkuk, which is what I almost named Emma. Somebody thought it was funny. I need a little help up here. We are going to be jumping around a bit, so we'll be reading Habakkuk 1, 1 through 5, Habakkuk 2, 2 and 3, and Habakkuk 3, 2. And now I don't have to say the name many more times. The oracle or prophecy that Habakkuk the prophet received. How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you don't listen? Or I cry out to you, violence, but you do not save. Why do you make me look at injustice? Why do you tolerate wrong? Destruction and violence are before me. There is strife and conflict abounds. Therefore, the law is paralyzed and justice never prevails. The wicked hem in the righteousness, so that the justice is perverted. Then the Lord declares, look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed. For I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told. Then the Lord replied, write it down, the revelation, and make it plain on tablets, so that a herald may run with it. For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay. And then Habakkuk replied, Lord, I have heard of your fame. I stand in awe of your deeds, O Lord.
There are three stories I want to start off with this morning that will all tie together with this question on suffering and the question of why. Two of these I heard this past week that really just impacted me and touched me, and one comes from when I was a young man. The first one comes from a pastor by the name of Tim Chalice. He had a son named Nick. He was a 20-year-old college student. Actually, he was in seminary at Baptist Seminary in Louisville. And healthy, met a girl of his dreams. He pursued her for 3 years. 3 years until he finally got her to notice her and he started dating her, and they got engaged on August the 21st, 2020. They set a wedding date for that next year, May the 8th of 21. But while Nick was playing basketball, this healthy young man all of a sudden just collapsed on the court. For no reason, he just fell dead. His heart had stopped. And so on November the 3rd of 2020, he died. His dad was there and gave a speech about the impact his death had on him and how it hurt. But he talked about how he found comfort in his faith. He found comfort in knowing that even in the sorrow, that God was present with him. And I won't tell the whole story, but on the day that the wedding was supposed to take place, he had written a speech that he was supposed to deliver to his son on that day. And he couldn't read it because he was just so brokenhearted, but just on that day, there was another couple, a Christian couple, who had also lost their son many, many, many years ago, who was there, who prayed for him and comforted him and read the note for him. But he said that in the time of sorrow, his greatest sorrow, he found peace and comfort in the love of God shown through other folks. That's the first story. The second story comes from Jonathan Gibson. He is an Irish seminary professor at Westminster Theological Seminary. His wife and him were so excited they were going to have a second child, little Layla. Big brother was so happy and couldn't wait for the baby to come home. They had the crib ready, had the room decorated, everything set. But just 4 days before the due date, they realized something was wrong. They went to the doctor, and their worst fears were confirmed. Layla would be stillborn. As he told the story, he asked the question why, but he said it always came back that he found comfort in his faith. He said the thing that got him through was the song we sang this morning, What is Our Hope in Life and Death? That is from the Heidelberg Catechism, and he said that he would just say that over and over and over and over. Because the answer to that first question, what is our only comfort in life and death? What is our only hope in life and death? And is this, that I am not my own, but belong body and soul in life and death to my faithful Savior, Jesus Christ. He said, I was hurt, but by faith I knew my little daughter was with Jesus. And I knew she was taken care of. And so at his moment of greatest suffering, he found comfort in the truth of God, in the power of God, and in the doctrines of the church. That's the second story. The third story comes when I was stationed at Keesler Air Force Base. There was this Air Force girl. Her name was Airman BB, and she was a sweet little girl, had little chipmunk cheeks. I don't know if y'all know folks like that, the little chipmunk cheeks, and always smiling, just so sweet. And she was just wonderful and the sweetest person you've ever met. And so we always went out, just a group of us, and so we were there talking about different topics, and we came to a topic of religion. And I shared that I was a Christian, I was a believer, and then Airman Beebe said, I'm actually an atheist. And I was shocked, because she wasn't wearing all black, didn't have black fingernails, and didn't, you know, cast a spell. And she did not look like an atheist to me. She wasn't angry. She was sweet. She was loving. She was kind. She was compassionate. But yet I asked her, I said, okay, now this is why I believe in Jesus Christ. Why don't you? And her response was simply this. How can there be a God when there is so much evil and pain in this world? If God is as good as you say, then they would not have all this suffering going on in the world. And she wouldn't get into details, but I could tell if this just wasn't a vague statement, but that there was something personal there. Something had happened in her life, and so at her moment of deepest suffering and deepest pain, her response was not to draw near to God, but to push away and to say, God does not exist. But I tell you, this is the question we all have to ask eventually. If God is all good and God is all powerful, why is there so much pain and suffering in this world? If God has the power to end suffering, why doesn't he do it? If God loves us, shouldn't he want to end our pain and suffering? Why doesn't he do it? How can this be? And that's why we always say as Christians, there are basically four truths that we always hold in tension. And these four truths are this. God exists. God is omnipotent. He is all-powerful. Nothing is impossible for God, right? God is good all the time, and all the time God is good. God is all-loving. We learn in Scripture, God is love. But yet we know from experience, evil and suffering exist. How do you make all four of these go together? Now what happens, a lot of times people will try to make sense of this by removing one of the four. So like Airman Beebe, they say, well, there's evil and suffering, so it must mean there's no God. Their response is atheism. Get rid of God. Some will say, well, maybe God is not as loving as you think. Maybe God is like the gods of Greek mythology. He is mean, he is capricious, he is just mean to us. I was in seminary, and one of my professors went the other route. She said that God was not all-powerful. She said that God wants to end pain and suffering, he just doesn't have the power to do so. But I was like, that's not my God. My God is all powerful. My God is all loving. So the fourth response some folks have is that they say, well, maybe suffering is just illusionary. It's not real. If you had more faith, you wouldn't experience that. And so pain and evil and suffering are not real. But we know that's not true. Have y'all ever wrestled with that? Have you ever thought of those questions? If you did, you're not the first one to do so. Katie read the passage so wonderful. It's about the prophet Habakkuk. And I'll say that there is no right or wrong way to say the name Habakkuk, okay? And in Hebrew, it's one of those words that we just don't know how to pronounce it. So if y'all want to call him Herbert, okay? But Habakkuk was a prophet about the same time as Jeremiah, and both him and Jeremiah, no one liked what they were saying. He lived in a time where there were bad kings. The priesthood was corrupt, the culture was corrupt, there was injustice, the worship of God was empty, and it was geared more to accommodate the culture than to worship actually God. The people actually had gotten to the point where they were calling good evil and evil good. I don't want y'all, does that not sound familiar? This was a time he lived in, and he saw all of this around him. And he looked at God, and Habakkuk had one of the boldest prayers. I don't know if any of us would be bold enough to pray. But in verse 2, look what he says. He says, "How long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? I cry out to you violence, but you do not save." In other words, God, I'm telling you all the things wrong. What are you doing about it? Nothing. You're not even listening to what I am saying to you. And it goes on. Further verses, he claims that by doing nothing, God is actually tolerating wrong. That God is okay with the evil. And then we won't look at it on the screen, but in verse 4, he says that the law is paralyzed, faith is paralyzed. Where we're trying to live a good life, we can't because there's evil around us and the righteous are hemmed in. There is so much evil, I feel like I can't go left or right or forward or backward without me being corrupted by this culture around me. Lord, why aren't you doing anything about it? And then later he will say, "Are you not the Almighty? Do you not love us?" And so this is the dilemma we have. And if we were to look at just our own experience at the moment with our limited human understanding, I'd have to say we agree. Life is unfair. Life is terrible. And it seems like God is absent. But what God is going to tell Habakkuk is what he tells us is that he's going to take our little dilemma and he's going to add two things to it. He's going to add the concept of time and his promise. He's going to add time and his promise. Look at verse 5. "Look at the nations and watch for and be utterly amazed, for I am going to do something in your days that you would not believe even if you were told." God says, you know, he says, "How long?" And God says, "Just wait. You're going to see what I'm actually doing, and one day you're going to stand back and say, wow. You don't see it now, but one day you will." And then he goes on, "For the revelation awaits an appointed time. It speaks of the end and will not prove false. If I say it, it will happen." God is faithful. God is true. God has never lied. "It will not prove false. Though it linger, wait for it. It will certainly come and will not delay." And I love the promise in verse 14. "For the earth will be filled with the knowledge of the glory of the Lord as the waters cover the seas." He says, wait. You think I'm okay with all this? I'm not. But I have a plan set in place. I am at work and you don't see it. But trust me. Trust me, I will take care of this. And so what this means for us is a new way of looking at this the dilemma. Since God is all-powerful, then he can and will defeat evil and end pain and suffering. Since God is all-loving, he can and will end all pain and suffering in his people. One day. Therefore, one day, God will defeat evil and end all suffering just as he has promised. And we wait for that day. Okay, that requires patience on our part. What that means is that we need to realize this world is not the best possible world to live in. I love our world. It's a great place. You know, I could break out in Louis Armstrong. The skies are blue. <You know? laughs> It's a beautiful world, but it's not the best possible world. Because remember, this world was created, and you were created by God for one purpose, to love him and be loved by him and give him the glory. That's why you exist, to love God and be loved by him. But here's the thing. In order to love, you have to have the choice. And so we were created with free will. And we're going to look at this in a few weeks as we look at the origin of evil, but I'll just give you a little snapshot. It means that though God is sovereign, he willingly allowed us to go against his will. God had made us to the point where if we just want a perfect world, he could have said, you have no choice. But if you don't have no choice, you can't love. It's kind of like this. Imagine if you could create a kid who never disobeyed, a kid who always listened, a kid who had to love you, not because they were afraid of you, but because they had no other option. Always behaved, always did everything perfectly, always did, and just was right by your side. The thing is, you would not have a kid, you would have a toaster. Because love requires a choice. And if you're going to have a choice, you have to have the option. One of the things, when I read Genesis 3 the first time, I always thought to myself, if God did not want them to eat of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, why did he put it in the garden in the first place? But if you're going to have the choice to obey, you have to have the option of not obeying. If you're going to have the choice to love, you have to have the choice not to love. And so when we chose wrong, all creation fell with us. We'll look at more detail in a few weeks. But a few questions that come with this. Well, can't God just make people love him? No, because then it wouldn't be love. Well, can't God just make the impact of sin go away? You know, just kind of like, well, why can't God make it? We can go to the Golden Corral buffet, eat all we want, never gain any weight. Why not just remove the consequences of sin? Paul Copeland had a wonderful saying about this. He said, if God were to remove pain and suffering so that the consequences of sin would be hidden from us, we would live in an illusionary world, having the illusion that we were doing fine without being reconciled to God. If we never experienced the consequences of sin, we would never be dissatisfied with our separation from God. In other words, we live in a fallen, sinful world, and we have to realize we live in a fallen, sinful world, and we look forward to the day when there'll be no more. Well, the other question is, well, why can't God just end all pain and suffering now? End evil now. Well, here's the question. If God was going to end all evil at midnight tonight, where would you be at 12:01? That's a scary thought, isn't it? C.S. Lewis said it best, that people don't realize what they're asking when they ask God to end all pain and suffering, because he says, when the director walks on the stage, the play is over. We go home. And it's over. But Peter tells us why God is delaying his return. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 9. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. He is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. God's given us every chance to return back to him. And so in the meantime, what this means for us is that we are moving to a world where love will be perfected by free will. Evil and suffering will be no more. The song of the redeemed will be sung by those who have been washed in the blood of the Lamb. We'll be able to praise Him and just glorify Him after experiencing the greatest love we had, could ever imagine. But that day is not yet. And so it requires three things of us. Faith, hope, love. Faith, hope, love. So what does this mean for us? First of all, it means in suffering, we have to have the faith and trust in God and His promises. I told you all about Jonathan Gilbert, the man whose daughter was stillborn. His son, who was a little toddler, had asked his dad, "Dad, why is not my baby sister coming home?" His dad had prepared his son for this question. And he did it this way. Every night they'd look outside and look for the moon. And he'd say, "What does the moon look like?" And he'd say, "It looks like a toenail." But he'd say, "But what shape is the moon?" And he said, "The moon is always round." And so he took his son's experience and put it into a book, y'all. It's a wonderful little book called The Moon is Always Round. But he said, no matter what the moon looks like, it never changes the fact that it's always round. And his son understood that, and he understood to mean this: God is good all the time. You may not see it, but it doesn't change. God is good. And if we wait one day, we'll see it again. We have to have that faith and that trust that the promises of God will hold firm. Second of all, in our suffering, we have hope that the day is coming when God will end all pain and suffering. Now, this is a long text, but I just so powerful. 1 Peter chapter 1. Praise be to the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. In His great mercy, He has given us new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade, kept in heaven for you, who through faith are shielded by God's power until the coming of the salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. Y'all see all the hope built up? In this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while you may have had to suffer grief in all kinds of trials. These have come so that your faith of greater worth than gold, which perishes even though refined by fire, may be proved genuine and may result in praise, glory, and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Though you have not seen Him, you love Him. And even though you do not see Him now, I love that, you don't see Him now, you believe in Him and are filled with an inexpressible and glorious joy, for you are receiving the goal of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the hope. One day, God's going to fix everything. One day, it's all going to be good. Sin and suffering and pain will be no more. But we have to wait. And while we wait in our suffering, we need to stay close to God's love and rejoice in His glory and our salvation. Habakkuk wrestled with this question, but I want you to know how he ended his book. Habakkuk ended this way in Habakkuk 3, verse 17. We said this verse many times. Though the fig tree does not bud, and though there are no grapes in the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle stalls, meaning life stinks. Nothing is going right. Yet, because of what God has promised, what God has done for me, what God will do for me, because of who God is, even though all this has happened, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The moon is always round. God is good all the time. I can't see it, but I will wait. But understand this, in our suffering, God will use it for His glory and work and abide with us in it. But I will close with this, that we must remember that God is never absent from our pain. Remember last week, we looked at the question, my God, why have you forsaken me? Who said that? Jesus. He bore our sin, our pain. You see, the darkest day the world has ever seen was not 9/11. The darkest day was not when your crisis happened, when you lost your job, when you lost that loved one. The darkest day was when the Creator of creation was crucified. But it also became the most glorious day, because in that day, we were set free. The old hymn goes this way. He took my sin and my sorrows and made them his very own. And he bore the burden on Calvary and suffered and died alone. And if y'all would just humor me for a little moment, would you sing this part? I'm in a singing mood after this week. So sing this with me. How marvelous, how wonderful, and my song shall ever be. How marvelous, how wonderful is my Savior's love for me. Amen.
Let's stand as we sing together our closing hymn, I Will Rise.
There's a peace I've come to know, though my heart and flesh may fail. There's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. Victory is one. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when he calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise.
what a promise we have. Let's bow our heads for a benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and give you peace. May we go forth knowing we are loved by God, knowing we go forth as ambassadors for his kingdom, knowing that we go forth to serve and love him by serving others. Now, Lord, bless us and keep us safe, now and forevermore. Amen.